So, Dills, J-Dog back in some more goddamn questions. Questions we're going over today is, first, I got an email question. Bust that out real quick. And it's from Harry Quinn, goddammit. You guys recognize him in the fucking comment section. J-Dog, hopefully not too personal of a question, but it looks as though you were heavier when you first started the channel. Going off your face, compare your videos from this winter to the video from January 2022, where you show off your jacket and you seem quite a bit heavier on the latter, question mark. Am I just seeing things, or was that the case? If so, did you change up your routine, or was this there a reason for this? So I thought this was a pretty cool question, and also, too, a little weird coming from Harry, because if I'm not mistaken, I could be mistaken. Harry, aren't you the one that's trying to turn pro? Or at least competitive bodybuilder. There was somebody that contacted me, talked in email. I thought it was you. I believe he was in the UK. Are you in the United Kingdom, Harry? I know you've ordered from us and you comment, but and we've talked a little bit about bodybuilding back and forth through email. So if I'm mistaking it wasn't you, then that's on me. But I thought it was you. So coming from you, I thought you would understand this 110%. I thought that was a little weird. I was definitely heavier. I personally pushed my weight up in January. Now, am I going to do it this year? I don't know. We'll see. But the thing is you can see on camera, this camera is terrible. It's not a true representation of anything, especially if you're trying to judge a physique or anything on it. Is literally like, but you can see the difference in just how I look in my face. That's how it should be. You see all these guys that go to the gym, dude, and like 10 years, like they look the same. It's like, dude, I've never seen you change. You should get bigger and you should get leaner at times. It's like, so why do I look different? Because I know what the fuck I'm doing. And that's what it is. You bulk up, you put on the muscle, and you're going to put body fat on with it. You try to keep the body fat to a minimum. You should always at least see your abs somewhat, especially first thing in the morning when you're the most dehydrated, when you get out of bed. You should always at least see your top four abs at least a little bit. If you can't see anything, no outline, then you're too fucking fat. So that's the measuring gauge. And so then during those time, I'd get up to like 240, 245. Now I'm hovering in the low 200s. So it's like 40 pounds. That's what it fucking takes. And that's what I keep telling all these guys. Like, yeah, dude, the guys that walk around the gym and shit, thinking they're jacked as fuck. They're like, I'm 245 and stuff. And they're not even a good 245. I'm like, dude, I diet you down, you're a buck 75, buck 80. If I get you fucking shredded. What the fuck are you talking about? I got like 10 pounds. You ain't gonna notice anything. The first 10 pounds, if you got a little bit of chunk on you, you diet down, you are not gonna notice anything with 10 pounds. Nothing. Most people have at least 30 pounds to fucking lose. I'm talking about people that aren't even fat. And that's if you want to get lean, ripped, meaning striations in your chest, fucking vascularity all throughout your arms, the separation when you fucking do it, you know, front double bicep, your abs fully in, detail in your back. We're talking that kind of shit. Striations. You should have separation in your legs and your quads when you flex them. You should see separation. If you don't, you're too fat. There's too much fat on them. Now, there's nothing wrong with that if that's not your goal. But to get there, yeah, you're carrying at least 30 pounds. And that's if you're a respectable weight. So that's what it takes, yeah. So, like, yeah, that's why people at the gym, like, I would say 95% of people that go to the gym are just fucking around. Completely fucking around. And, well, how do you know they're fucking around? Because they look the same year after year. You should not look the same all year round. The only way that you should is if you've been doing this for well over 10 years, you've reached your maximum size you want to be, muscle mass-wise, genetically, and to be honest, that's why I'm saying I might not bulk up this January, because I'm pretty sure I'm at that fucking limit, which is fucking pathetic, because I'm not even that goddamn big, but it's a bit fucking depressing, but that's a whole other goddamn conversation. Once you reach that limit, there's no point of bulking and shit. You're just dicking around. You're just putting on body fat for no goddamn reason, not to put on any more pounds or even ounces of muscle, lean contractile tissue. Because when you diet down, you should be at least a few pounds heavier. Well, my last two diets, I pretty much come back down to the same goddamn number. So it's like, all right, well, did I even put on any goddamn muscle? So was it even worth it? Not really. So someone like in that category, what you do is just, once you get to that size, diet down, get really lean, and just fucking maintain that. That's the only time you should look the same year around. 99.9% of people are not in that goddamn fucking category. You're always trying to get bigger or leaner. It's like, well, why aren't you, dude? I've literally seen you coming here for the last year, 2 years, some guys 5, 10 years. I was like, and you look exactly the same. exactly the same. So know the fuck they're doing. As far as what did I change? All I changed was my diet. Foods stay the same. Quantities go up. And then when I'm bulking and shit like that, there's a little bit more junk and shit like that just to get calories up. Because good luck with this metabolism like mine, eating all just clean foods. All these guys think they could, dude, you're not going to be able to do it. Just chicken, rice, steak and rice, fucking oatmeal and eggs. You're not going to be able to get the calorie count that's required if you have a fast metabolism and all that. You're going to have to fucking dirty it up a little bit. You get your base in, so you're getting all your essentials, you know what I mean, in. So you eat that first, and then you add in a little bit more fun shit just because it's easier to consume. Get your caloric calories up. That's it. But gym routine, exactly the same. Training stays exactly the same. When you get lighter, the weights come down a little bit, not intentionally. You don't pull your weights down intentionally, but just because you're going to get a little bit weaker no matter what, even if, with body fat. If you're 40 pounds lighter, you're not going to be as strong. Anyone that tells you otherwise is completely full of shit and lying out of their fucking teeth. You're going to be a little bit weaker. So, but the bloom would stay the same and shit like that. Just the weights come down a little bit. That's it. That's the secret. Same fucking shit year round, brah, brah. Anyways, a few questions I didn't finish up off videos, and then I should have time to pull up the next goddamn video. Robert G., how's that poser dismemberment shirt coming along? Kramer, how's that goddamn art coming along, goddammit? It's on him. He said he was going to start it last month. Maybe he did, but he didn't tell me that he did, so I'm going to assume that he didn't. Andrea Gabriel, I only really like the demos when it comes to Massacre. They debuted as such a downgrade, though it's not the worst thing ever. Just really watered down. The Massacre demos, especially the first demo, Death in Hell, that's one of the greatest death metal fucking demos ever. And it does seem to be, I would say 30% of the people are in the know on that. 70%, I'm talking about guys even that I'm not talking about idiots that don't know fucking shit, that think 200 stab wounds is the most greatest thing since sliced bread, or that's the most underground thing they've heard. Not talking about those fucktards. They don't know shit. But I'm talking about guys that actually know their metal, know demos. A good portion of them don't even fucking bring that shit up. And it's like, dude, yeah, that's literally one of the greatest death metal demos ever. I'm not going to say the greatest, but I'd say it's in the top 10. Top 10 for sure. The Massacre demos, but specifically the first goddamn demo, the 86 demo, Death in Hell. From Beyond, yeah, it is. It's a downgrade. It's 100% down. That's a funny thing, too. Most Massacre fans, they don't even know the demos. Again, I'd say 50-50. But a lot of them, yeah, I like Massacre less than like From Beyond. I'm like, that's like the best worst thing they have. What I mean by that is, out of their good shit, it's the worst thing they have. And obviously, then they have shitty shit. But it's like, yeah, the demos, dude. If you want to have it cleared, get out the Iron Pegasus CD. Let me just show you. There's an LP and CD they put out years ago. Cover sucks fucking dick. I don't know what he was thinking on that, but masterpiece of a goddamn release, and you'll have the best Massacre shit. You can throw that From Beyond the fucking garbage compared to this having this goddamn thing. Tyrants of Death CD. This came out several years ago. There's an LP, a picture disc, both, of course, goddamn it, and then a CD. The CD you should be able to get at Discogs or something like that. Band photo. Got a bunch of photos and shit in there, early stuff, you know. This is mandatory metal. When I look at a metal collection, I'm thinking, why isn't that there? Like, this is shit I brush my teeth to. This is a very often spin. 10 out of 10, like, blows away 90% of any of these dumbass albums that you probably own. That's come out in the last 10 years. So what's on here then is the demo 2 is first. I don't know why you put the second demo first, which is great though. Demo 1, which the, I always call it Death in Hell. I don't know if it's titled Death in Hell, but it was the first demo, and Aggressive Tyrant, Death in Hell, and Mutilated. Fucking great. And then there's the live demo. It's, how does he put it on here? Songs 9 through 14, just live. May 25th, 1986 in Tampa. But from what I understand, I think it was Dawn of the Dead that told me that was kind of handed out as a live demo. But nonetheless, it's fucking great, and it's got the just like the Traitor on there. And to my knowledge, the Traitor's not on anything else. So that was an unreleased song. I think that was the only unreleased song. But that's the cool talking with Cam Lee on it. Rambo imitation. That type of shit. I mean, It's funny, people in the know know, and you go around, just randomly walk up to them and go, Rambo imitation. They know what you're talking about. That's how I know we're on the same page. We listen to the same shit. But 95% of people aren't going to know that. Because that, to me, that's shit. Like I said, that's a regular spin. That, again, it was funny because it was, I think it was a chick, too, that said in the comments, like, why is he always ripping on these new bands that got popular? I don't understand. Is it like this elitist thing? Just talking shit because the bands got popular? It's not that. I'm just using them as an example because they are the popular ones. That someone walking around and they're like, yeah, like fucking, like they're talking, they're in the loop because they listen to Frozen Soul, but they have no, but they don't own that. Don't know. I'm like, dude, you're completely not only missing out, and I'm just trying to like, just make you up, like help you out, buddy. Like let you know Santa Claus isn't real, that type of shit. Like I'm just trying to give you help a hand. If you like that, brah, there's shit that's a million times fucking better. Again, I saw them live, thought it was pretty good. But again, pretty good. It's not Massacre Demos good. It's, but so if you're talking death metal, it's kind of like, it's again, another analogy is kind of like the guy that's like, man, dude, he's going to get a hot and ready fucking pizza, fucking Little Caesars. Like, this is the best pizza ever, dude. It's so fucking good. You ever tried one of those hot and readies? Holy fuck. But he's never had any other pizza places, like any great mom and pop shop or Giannino's Pizza or places that just will fucking knock his socks off, right? And you're just like, dude, yeah, it's fine. That's the best way I can do it. The 200 stab wounds and Frozen Souls, it's a hot and ready fucking pizza from Little Caesars compared to what's out there. And the predecessors that were way before, and it's usually the predecessors. It's a hot and ready pizza. You put it on, you're like, yeah, this was impressive for $5. It's pretty good. But if it's like, hey, J-Dog, you're going to the electric chair tomorrow and pizza's on the menu, are you going to pick hot and ready? No. that's the only reason I'm talking about it. And again, I love it when people are like, this elitist, he only rips on these bands because they got popular. Rah-rah. They're not popular? Who do I praise? Up, down, left, right, front and center. Cannibal, The Tish, Deicide, Merciful Fate, Carcass. Bands are popular as fucking shit. Like, what are you talking about? I've said it a million times. Slayer Show No Mercy is probably the greatest metal record ever fucking written. If aliens were to come down from outer fucking space, they bumped into old J-Dog, and they said, man, we heard about this fucking metal music stuff. Like, so what's it all about? I don't feel like explaining it to your dumb ass, because quite frankly, I'm not your fucking daddy. I don't speak your goddamn fucking alien green goddamn language. Here's Show No Mercy. Give that a fucking spin 10 times with the goddamn lyrics. You'll have the basic guy. That's metal. That's what metal represents. No baggy fucking pants. No stupid sports jerseys. No singing about dumb shit. Down with the fucking devil. Where it started. Killer fucking solos. Everything. And it was at the forefront. That's what I give him. I mean, how's that being elitist? Slayer Show No Mercy? What the fuck? I mean, how many of those sold over the thing? A million? I don't even know. A lot? So that comment don't make goddamn sense. Just trying to help some devils out, goddamn it. Any the fuck who? What the fuck? We got, we talking about Massacre or something in that video? Mark Colby Marks. Man, I'd have to say Cam Lee is probably my favorite voice for death metal. Killer ass fucking voice. And I will say this. And what do you guys, let's put it in, put in the comments. What do you think? From what I've heard this secondhand, supposedly said in interviews and shit like that, or at least I think he said in interviews or he said it publicly and people have told me, or maybe not publicly, maybe he said it just in person and they told me, but I never heard this firsthand and I didn't read this. But nonetheless, I guess it's supposedly said that Cam Lee is somewhat bitter with the scene, that he doesn't get the recognition for creating the death metal growl. And that's, I mean, because realistically, when you say death metal growl, like who created the Cookie Monster vocals? You know what I mean? That type of shit. Who created it? Usually, a lot of people, if you type, go to any fucking these random ass trendy fucking YouTube channels, they're probably going to say Chris Barnes, Frank Mullen, maybe Glenn Benton. I would say that's probably who, one of those three they're going to throw out there. or they're going to say it's an argument between those three of who started it. I kind of agree with Cam. Dude, 86, this fucking first demo that's on here. He's growling, right? Who had growling vocals before that? Who? Death didn't. And as far as Chuck Schuldiner, now here's the thing, where he'll probably, I think he gets a slightly carried away with his argument, because he's saying, I'm sure some of these fucking bozos watching this even know this, did you know that Cam Lee was the first singer for Death? Again, dude, come on, put down your fucking Sanguizio nutsack, man, and get in the goddamn loop. Band was called Mantis. That was initially Death. They put out two demos. Death by Metal, Reign of Terror demo, both in 1984. Cam Lee sings on both of those. Not Chucky. Cam, I think, either left or he was fired. I can't, don't know. I've heard the stories both ways. I've heard he quit and I heard he was fired. I've heard it both ways. He, on those demos, I think he goes back and says, well, yes, I've been growing since 1984. Keep in mind, those are some of my fucking favorite demos, especially the first one, Death by Metal. Legion of the fucking Doom on there, opening track, which never made it on the goddamn album. Granted, one of the riffs they did end up using on one of the songs in Spiritual Healing, but that demo fucking song and the original smokes it. But anyways, it was recorded in whatever, a garage or their mom's basement or whatever. The vocals sounded much more barking or kind of yelling. Now, maybe he was growling like he did in Massacre, but you could not tell. So I'm going to have to... If I was to be the fucking guy just kind of like in the middle of the debate and trying to be as unbiased as possible, and somebody saying, Chris Barnes, you know, he's the one that created the death metal guy, I mean, the death metal vocals, the Cookie Monster vocals, and Cam's over here in the other chair saying, no, it was me, I've been doing it since 1984, and fucking J-Dog's narrating the goddamn thing, trying to keep the peace. I'd be like, well, Cam, I mean, I'm going to have to backpedal on those demos. I mean, they don't really sound like growls. Maybe you were, but it's how the recording picked up. Now, I like how his vocals sound. Oh, they sound aggressive, but they're almost more like, almost like the hardcore style mixed with like what death metal would kind of become. You just kind of couldn't tell because they were so goddamn raw, right? So I will say, can't really say that, but still, prior, let's just go 86. The first, let's say when he started Massacre. Who's growling before that? Possessed Seven Churches, that's not a growl. Insanity, Fire, Death, Fate for demo, 1985. That's not a growl. What demo? Again, put down your stupid shit, Rob Rock. Get in the fucking loop. No real metal. Great fucking vocals, but that's more of the kind of like that Slaughter Lord, maybe Morbid Angel, that screechy fucking yell slash snarl. Not, it wasn't a growl. However the fuck you want to narrate those. So I'm trying to think of shit like death metal that was prior. Morbid Angel, Abomination to Desolation. That was 86, I'm almost positive, right? But any of those fucking demos with Dallas War singing, which was Cheeballs as shit, regardless, though, that's not a growl. Then that Kingdom Come demo, granted, that's not really a growl, but I guess you can maybe kind of argue, still, that was 87. Massacre's first demo was 86. So who was growling before 86, or even in 86? I can't think of anybody. So to be completely honest, I do think Cam Lee created the goddamn, the death metal growl, the Cookie Monster vocals, whatever you want to call them. And yeah, I don't think he gets the fucking credit. Dude, because I'm telling you right now, half these fucking bozos, like think about it. Massacre, yeah, they're known, they're well known in the scene, and 85% of the people watching this goddamn shit either know or listen to Massacre, at least something by them, at least Minimally From Beyond, right? But they're nowhere near the size of fucking Deicide, Cannibal. Again, dude, it's these fucking Panini's goddamn poser-ass fucking douche canoes that they just followed because it's popular. Again, I automatically assume if you coming up to me, baseball cap or not, sports jersey or not, and you're wanting to rub elbows and you're telling me I listen to death metal. That's what you're saying. I listen to Deicide. I like Cannibal, bro. Suffocation. Fuck yeah. That type of lingo, I automatically assume you know who Massacre is, and at very fucking least think it's pretty good. Man, From Beyond, it wasn't great. You know, Effigy of the Forgotten was much more brutal, but at least know it and are aware of it and have heard it. I automatically assume that. If you haven't, you're probably not very much into this goddamn shit. You're just not. I don't know what else to fucking tell you. Like, that's just a given. It's as dumb as one video I said that there's the kids that I'm saying on that Hellcast episode of Craig or whatever. Never heard of this member. What? And again, then going back, those are the guys probably listen to fucking Gate Creeper and Frozen Soul. And it's like, again, that shit's fine. There's nothing wrong with it. I'm not ripping on it. I'm just using it because, hey, if you're the big boys, you get used as the big boys. That's why Cannibal gets used a lot, other than being favorite band, first band I heard, first death metal band I heard, because they're the biggest one. So they're going to get used as the analogy. They're the goddamn benchmark. So today's bands, well, people, why do you keep bringing up 200 game bands? You can't read it about, because they're the benchmark of today. If there's not, who the fuck else is? They're the forefront, right? Am I wrong? Correct me if I'm wrong. Today's, as far as the bands that come out in the last, let's say, 10 years, biggest bands in the death metal scene are Frozen Soul, 200 Stab Wounds, Cinquisio Bog, and Gate Creeper, probably. Am I wrong? It's probably them. Maybe there's somebody I'm slipping by and unaware of, but I'm pretty sure it's those. So those are the benchmarks, and that's what I'm going to use. And I'm telling you, I guarantee you, 95% of those kiddos that listen to that shit, well, for sure, 95% of them haven't even heard these goddamn Master demos and completely fucking unaware. And here's the thing, what is goddamn elitist? And they're so hard to get. No, they're not. It's come out several times. It's been bootlegged a million times, and it's come out officially. And I know fucking Costover and Iron Pegasus pressed the shit out of this disc because we had it hand over fist times. Now, it's been a while. I'll give you that. But you can easily find it on Discogs or eBay. Now, I didn't look, but I'll bet you anything you could find on there for 15, 20 bucks. The LP might be a little bit more expensive, but I guarantee you, even that's reasonable. I guarantee you it's not $100. I guarantee you could probably get an LP for less than $100 in Discogs. Nothing outlandish. People pay that for fucking Bathory Yellow Goat cover shit. Music they do have over music they don't have. And again, but even, okay, the demos. But I'm telling you, 80% of them, of those kiddos, don't even know From Beyond. Don't even bring it up. How do you know or care about, like, it just... To me, it's just ass backwards. You shouldn't know these fucking newbies before From Beyond. It's the hot and ready, man. You're literally just shooting yourself in the foot. You're picking up the hot and ready over the scrumptious fucking Juninos. Juninos was a million times better, brah, brah. Hot and ready, yeah, it's fine. Not having it before the goddamn electric chair, though. I'm damn sure it's fucking spinning goddamn death and hell, though, before the goddamn electric chair. You best believe that's what's going on fucking the dogs player. Come switch the energy to the look at you, but the God's wrath can't answer right in the morning. Later, goddammit.